The University of Pennsylvania is without a doubt one of the most competitive schools in the world, with more than 65,000 people applying every single year and only 6.5% of those applicants being accepted. It's the dream of so many young people. A couple weeks ago, I was admitted into the Penn Graduate School of Education to do my master's in education, specifically in the field of education technology. And I was also fortunate enough to receive a scholarship there. It's called a merit scholarship. It's only a small one, but it's still a scholarship. So what I thought I'd do is today just go through my resume and my personal statement and talk about how I got into that school and hopefully give you guys some insights and some advice. Over the last 2 weeks, I also talked about how I got into Harvard and how I got into Stanford. So if you want to go check out those videos, I highly recommend that you do if those are on your dream school list as well. This video is likely going to be a little bit shorter just because the requirements for my program specifically are actually quite limited. Literally all you have to do is submit your resume, of course recommendation letters, and then a 750-word statement of purpose. That's all you get, 750 words, which is not a lot. As context, Harvard required 1,500 words plus many supplementals, and Stanford was 1,000 words with a lot of supplemental questions as well. So Penn, very short, very sweet, but hopefully you'll be able to see how you can concisely convey everything that you need to in a personal statement in a short space of time. So I hope that's what is the value of today's video. So I'm just gonna start with my resume. That's probably the easiest place to start to help provide context to my statement of purpose. I'll put in timestamps if you just wanna skip straight to the statement of purpose, but maybe this can give you some ideas of the types of things you'd like to accomplish. So I just structured my resume pretty simply. It's 3 pages long. I've just got my education, my professional experience in my field of interest, which is education technology. Then I've got my book publications, honors and awards, sporting achievements, and then just community impact and hobbies towards the end. So a very diverse resume, but this is definitely a way in which you can structure yours if you don't currently have a template. So let's just quickly jump into this. I won't spend more than a couple minutes walking you through my experiences. I'll screenshot everything so you can take a look and read through it in your own time. So in regards to education, so I studied mechanical engineering at my local university as a 4-year degree. I did my thesis in environmental engineering, even though I studied mechanical engineering, and I got a GPA of around 6.742 out of 7 and a WAM of about 84% and first class honors. So nothing too fancy there, to be honest. Basically, first class honors is the highest honors that you can achieve in Australia, and all you have to do is average above 80% and you receive it. So it's impressive, but it's nothing standout-ish, I would say, because I didn't really top any of my units. I definitely was never going to be valedictorian, but again, evidence that you can get into your top schools without really having those perfect results, because what really matters is everything else, to be honest. This is just more of a checkpoint that you'll be okay with the coursework, and then what they're really interested in is your personal background. So going into my professional experience in education, as context, I'm only 23 at the moment, so I probably don't have as much to show as other people, but I made the most of my first 23 years of my life, and I think that's why I was able to get a scholarship to Penn, because they saw how ambitious and excited I was to go there. So the first thing is I've co-founded 2 education non-for-profits that are specifically focused around writing high school textbooks for kids, giving them access to online content and the videos that they need to succeed in school. So I've managed those 2 non-for-profits over the last few years, poured my heart and soul into those, and now just kind of taking more of an advisory role at this point. I've also had some research experience at my local university, just working in this field of mental health. I've produced my own documentary, which is tied to a book that I wrote. And then finally, I just managed a university level non-for-profit. So kind of just a couple experiences there. But what I'm just showing is on the first page is that I'm very passionate about education. It's the field that I've spent all my time working towards, even though I studied engineering, and therefore I'm really excited to join the program. Okay, the next page is just centered on my book publications. So I've published 6 books, just being co-authors for all those books. Most of them are just high school textbooks that I created through the non-for-profit that I managed. And then below that is the honors, awards, and distinctions. So most of my awards have not come from, they haven't come from being gifted academically, I would say. They're all centered around community impact and nonprofit leadership. So it's still really cool to win them, but nothing too serious there. They're just statewide awards for volunteering and community service, I would say, just because I spent so many hours. The next section is just centered around my background in sport and Ninja Warrior specifically. I used to have a really big passion for it. And so I just spoke about all the different events I was able to compete in and also the commentating that I did because I love speaking, I love talking. So I did a lot of sports commentating for the Australian Ninja League and then the World Ninja League. So just spoke about that and then also a 24-hour pull-up challenge that I've founded. So again, these experiences are very unique to me. I think a lot of what I've done is quite unique. I don't think this is why I got into the school. This is just more so the experiences that shape my personal statement, which is the main and most important part of getting into these schools by a mile. And then the back page, I'll just leave a screenshot, but it's just all centered around community impact, more so just small little things that I've been involved in. So nothing too serious there, but hopefully that gives you some inspiration and ideas. I would say the personal statement is where we should really be focused on because this is something that's universal. Everyone's got to write one, and hopefully my structure can help. You know, I wrote, you've only got 750 words for pen, which is such a small amount of space to get across your life story, your professional experiences, your aspirations, and what you're going to do at the school, and also how you're going to contribute to the school potentially. So you've got to try and tie all of that into 750 words, which is not easy. So hopefully this will give you some ideas of how to go about doing that. So I'll put screenshots all throughout. We're just going to start reading. Mine's structured in not necessarily too unique of a way. I basically just spend the first 250 words talking about my background, my upbringing, and the experiences that have shaped my passion for education. So nothing about my professional experiences, very personal. The next half is about talking about my professional experiences and also my ambitions in life. So you'll see the unique format that I have. I actually use dot points, which is probably pretty rare in a personal statement. And then finally, the last 250 words is why I want to go to Penn, like really diving into the degree structure, what I'm going to gain from it. And I think that back half will be the most valuable for people. So I'll timestamp that just because, you know, if you go on a Penn, you might get some ideas of ways in which you could take advantage of these facilities as well. So I'm talking about, for me, it's the Master's Capstone Project, the teachers I want to work with and professors, and then also the on-campus, like out of the classroom experiences I want to have. So let's just get started. I'm just going to go paragraph by paragraph. There is one paragraph I'm going to skip over just because it's quite personal, but we'll deal with it when we get to it. Okay, let's start with the opening paragraph. It's nothing personal, but my Australian high school was not for me. I sat subserviently still for 5 days a week and found it impossible to pay attention to my teacher's monotone recitals for more than 10 minutes at a time. As a result, I taught myself through the online learning platform Khan Academy. Listening to the engaging voice of Sal Khan in his free education videos empowered me to thrive through school and inspired the work that I do today supporting tens of thousands of young Australians. So that's just talking about my experience going through school, which is I did do the majority of my learning through self-teaching and through learning online, which is why I love education technology and I understand the immense power that it has and the potential that it has. So that's the first one. You're going to notice for the first three paragraphs, or the first four paragraphs, sorry, that I start with the phrase, it's nothing personal or it's nothing Australia seems to be ashamed of, because it's a nice way to tie back and indicate that I'm talking about a new topic each time. So that's story number one. Now we're going to go on to story number two, which is very short because, again, 750 words is not a lot of space. It's nothing Australia seems to be ashamed of, but socioeconomic status is one of our strongest determinants of educational attainment. In my first year of university, I mentored a class of year 10 students in a low socioeconomic school just 20 kilometers outside of Perth, and I asked them, who here believes they can go to university? Out of 30 students, only two put their hands up. So in Australia, socioeconomic status is perhaps our strongest determinant of success. So if you're from a low socioeconomic background, you're on average going to be 3 years behind your peers from high socioeconomic backgrounds. So it's really bad and something that I've always been passionate about addressing, which is what I've been focused on through my non-for-profits, research, work, everything in between. The third paragraph, I'm not going to read it or show it just because it's to do with my own mental health experiences, but basically what I'm tying it to. It starts with, it's nothing Australian schools seem to care about, but high school failed my mental health. And what it talks to is the absence of social emotional learning in our schools. And you're gonna see why these personal experiences matter and why I've specifically chosen these ones, because they tie into the future ambitions that I have and the work that I've been doing over the last few years. Okay, so we've had three personal experiences and now we're gonna tie it into my professional experiences, because I haven't really done any kind of flexing. I haven't really said what my background is, what professional stuff I have to show. So now we're gonna go into that. It's nothing our education policymakers seem to be doing anything about, but millions of Australian students are just like me and the low socioeconomic students I mentored. As a 6-time co-author and the co-founder of one of Australia's largest edtech non-for-profit platforms, Elucidate Education, I have worked tirelessly to support more than 100,000 high school students by giving them equitable access to the textbooks, online content, and educational videos they need to succeed in school. Additionally, as a life skills educator, I have published my own non-fiction book called Realizing Dreams, made countless life education films, and taught thousands of students essential social-emotional skills through giving school speeches. However, these efforts only scrape the surface of my ambitions for giving millions of young Australians access to equitable and more holistic education opportunities. One of the biggest struggles that people have is articulating their personal experiences and professional experiences in a very concise manner. It's very typical of a statement of purpose or personal statement to be heavily focused on one's accomplishments, but that's what your resume is for. So what I would suggest is start your personal statement literally just talking about your life experiences. Touch on 2 or 3 very significant life experiences and then have a paragraph summarizing your professional experiences. Like, very concise, very brief, and tie them. The only reason that they should be there is because you're about to talk about your professional ambitions. Okay, so the back half of this personal statement, I think, is where it's going to be most valuable for you guys. When it comes down to accepting students into one of these Ivy League universities, in my opinion, the most important things are your ambitions and your understanding of how the school's going to help you to achieve those ambitions. Whilst being successful in the past is important, what they're more interested in is seeing people who are genuinely ambitious about the future and have really solid plans about what they're going to do. And so I think I did a really good job of laying out my ambitions for the future, for my lifetime, and then also how the program's going to help me to achieve those ambitions, which is a really valuable link. So I'm going to go through it now, and you're going to see that my ambitions are laid out in dot point form. And I think that's really unique, but it's very powerful because it's very clear. Clarity is king in a personal statement. So let's run through it. My ambitions are to develop 2 nationwide edtech initiatives that will significantly advance Australia's education equity and holistic education efforts. My first initiative aims to expand Elucidate Education Australia-wide to provide our 750,000 Year 10, 11, and 12 students with free access to all the textbooks, online content, educational videos, and assessment software they need to succeed in school. My second initiative aims to build a nationwide life education curriculum that will be freely available on the Elucidate Education platform. To do this, I plan to collaborate with experts in social-emotional learning to create videos and online content that will equip millions of young Australians with the knowledge they need to thrive beyond school. So I'm applying for education technology. I have 2 very clear edtech initiatives that also tie to my professional background. And I think that's a really powerful and potent combination, which is why I think I had so much success across Harvard, Stanford, Penn, and Columbia. And in also securing scholarships. Okay, now we're going to go into tying it to the program, which is, I think, again, probably going to be the most valuable part for everyone watching this video. So let's just jump into it. The MSED in Learning Sciences and Technologies at the Penn Graduate School of Education is the best program in the world to empower me to achieve these ambitions. For expanding Elucidate Education Australia-wide, I am excited to use my master's capstone project to explore how I can redesign my digital resources at Elucidate Education to be equity responsive in order to provide targeted support to marginalized Australian students. I am eager to pair this with the unit's design of learning environments and learning sciences past, present, future, taught by world-leading learning scientists, Professor Susan Yoon and Professor Bodong Chen. These units will allow me to gain a comprehensive understanding of design principles, learning theories, and frameworks, and how to use them to design education resources that are more inclusive for a wider range of student abilities. One thing I would preface when talking about university professors is to, first of all, read their bios, look at their research, and look at their LinkedIns, because if you make statements about professors that aren't true, for instance, I researched that these two professors are world-leading learning scientists, but if I made that statement and I was incorrect, it's going to look really bad on my application. So do your research into all the professors. It's long, arduous, and it takes a lot of time, but it's worthwhile to show you genuinely care about the types of people you're going to be working with over there. Okay, that was paragraph one. Now let's look at the second paragraph. For developing my life education curriculum, I plan to take curriculum design and assessment and ethnographic research methods to learn how to build a curriculum grounded in design principles and how to use ethnographic research methods to ensure the curriculum is suited for marginalized Australian students. By pairing this with a field experience unit at a local Philadelphia school, I can better understand the social-emotional challenges faced by students and fine-tune my curriculum to address these issues. Okay, now I'm going to close it out. Beyond the classroom, I'm excited to join the Penn Venture Lab to find my tribe of entrepreneurs, enter pitch competitions such as the Milk and Penn GSE competition, and co-develop social-emotional resources for the Penn GSE project for mental health and optimal development. It is for these reasons and many more that make Penn GSE the best place in the world to empower me to impact millions of young Australians. So that's my personal statement. It was actually really tough to write this one because 750 words is so short. Like, it might have even felt brief as I was reading that to you guys, just because 750 words is not a lot. But hopefully that gives you some ideas about how you can go about doing it. Something I'll suggest is when you're applying to schools, start with the schools that allow you to write more words. Start with the ones that can be 1,000 words long or 1,500 words long. And then it's easier to condense it once you have it longer because it's more comprehensive. But when you're working with such a limited amount of words and you're drafting it from scratch, it can make it extremely difficult. So I would say do that. But otherwise, I really hope that this just provides some genuine insights. Again, if you are thinking of applying to Harvard or Stanford, I would highly recommend you just go check out the videos that I did on those. Because hopefully, again, that'll give you some more ideas about how to structure your personal statement, the types of things you can talk about, and how you can elicit and explain your life experiences in a unique way. If you are applying to the University of Pennsylvania, I wish you all the best. You know, it's got a 6.5% acceptance rate, which is no joke. But if you believe in yourself, it's definitely possible. So good luck.